Voilà, ok, good. Well, thank you, Frédéric, for free time and for organizing these free time days. And also, so the talk by Pierre was a very good introduction to what I'm going to say now. So it's about the extension of the Jeannot decomposition method to the point problem. So this is a joint work with Pierre-Henri, who's in the room. And okay, so I'd like to stress as well the help of Jency, which is providing us computing hours on big national parallel computers. And they've been always very helpful from the beginning of the FreeFM parallel work, let's say. Okay, so first I will speak about saddle point problem. So why is that important and why is that difficult? I will recall very quickly, let's say, the theory of domain decomposition method on the Jeannot two-level solver for a symmetric positive definite problem. And then I will present what is new and which is its extension to saddle point problem. So Pierre spoke about extensions to algebraic formulation, and this is another direction of extension to saddle point problem. And then I will show some numerical results, and Pierre-Henri will show the FFDM script, which was used to perform the computation. So FFDM is a series of macro, let's say, for doing a domain decomposition method, but it is written in a FreeFM language compared to what Pierre showed before, which is written, which is where domain decomposition is accessed via HPDDM. Okay, so first saddle point problem. So this is when you have to solve this kind of linear system. So A and C are symmetric positive definite matrices, and but here you have a minus one minus sign, so that this matrix is symmetric, but it is not positive. And typical applications where you have this kind of thing are incompressible fluid computation, where the first unknowns, let's say U, are the velocity, and P, the pressure, and you have as well elasticity. But this kind of formulation is not restricted to pure incompressible flows or situations. It is also absolutely necessary when you have nearly incompressible situations. And for instance, when you have elasticity with rubber, so rubber is nearly incompressible, and you have to introduce pressure in order to have a stable discretization. Okay, so this is one big, let's say, applications, kind of applications. And the other ones are, which is very common, let's say, in computations, especially in mechanics, it is called multi-point constraints. So you want to say that this point will not move, for instance, and this one will not move in this direction, but can move in another one. So you add some lines to your system. And one common way to handle these extra lines that you had is to introduce Lagrange multiplier. And then once again, you have a saddle point problem. Okay, so in some situations, many people enjoy to use penalization because it enables them to bypass the problem of having a saddle point formulation. But then it is at the expense of approximation errors, of course, and second of round-off error issues, which can be tricky to handle because it will depend on the size of your problem, the precision of your computations, and so on. So if you want to be safe, it's better to have a saddle point formulation. So as I said, this matrix is symmetric but not positive. You can make it positive, simply you multiply the last line by minus one, and then it is positive, but then it is not symmetric. Okay. And this is an issue for iterative solvers, especially when you have discontinuous coefficients, and this is what we address in this work. If your problem is small enough, you can use direct solvers. And it will be the method of choice if your problem is small enough. And then you can use, for instance, the MUFS, Paradiso, SuperEliot. They are all accessible through FreeFM, either directly or through PETSIP. Okay, so now we want to address the situation where we have large-scale problems with many millions or some billions of degrees of freedom on hundreds or thousands of cores. And in the past year, let's say, for symmetric positive definite problem, even with high heterogeneities and discontinuities, both algebraic multigrid and domain decomposition method are now quite efficient. They are robust and fast, and you can use them. But for saddle point problem with arbitrary high heterogeneities, even when even though the fact that A is SPD and C is a symmetric positive semi-definite, these iterative solvers are not usable when you put them in difficult situations. And so what I will show here, which is new, is an extension of the Gineo domain decomposition method to saddle point problems. Okay, so first, recall on Gineo for symmetric positive definite problem. And for those who attended the previous pre-fam day, so the next two or three, four or five slides, you already know them. But, okay, so first, so say you have to solve a linear system when S is very large, billion or billions of unknowns. And you want to use a parallel computer to go parallel. Okay, so I will see. So what you can do is to decompose your set of degrees of freedom into two subsets. So two is an example, it could be many more than two. Depends on the number of cores you can use. And okay, so you decompose your set of degrees of freedom, and you can introduce the restriction operator, which takes a big vector, global vector, and keeps only the unknown corresponding to the subdomain Ni or subset Ni. And the transpose of this restriction operator is in fact the extension by zero of a local vector to a global vector. Okay, and here, for instance, you have a way to get this decomposition, so these two sets N1 and N2. What you can do is to create first an overlapping decomposition of your domain, and N1 will correspond to the degree of freedom which live in omega 1 and N2 for omega 2. Okay, so now you want to have some parallel algorithm which is iterative. So you want to go from an approximate solution UM to a better approximate solution UM plus 1. And you want to do something parallel. So the first thing you do in a linear algebra is first to compute the residual, which is F minus AUM, which is a way to measure how far you are from the exact solution. It should be zero, but it should not be zero until the convergence. And what you can do is to restrict this right-hand side to a local, to some subdomain, solve locally a problem on this subdomain, and then add this correction to the restriction of the previous solution to this subdomain. And so you can do these two steps in parallel for omega 1 and omega 2. And but you see that in the overlap, you have duplicated unknowns. So we want to update the global solution UM to UM plus 1. So we have to decide something on the overlap. And for this, we need to have a partition of unity, which is defined here at the algebraic level. So the simplest thing is to take local matrices DI, which are diagonal. And for instance, for the interior points, put half, and the same for D2. And in this way, you can weight the contribution of using this formula. Okay, and then when you work a little bit on this, you see that in fact what you have built is a preconditioner. Its formula is given here, and it is called the restricted additive Schwarz, so by Xai and Sarkis, and which has a compact formula. So now capital N is the number of subdomains, or the number of cores. And if you use this preconditioner with a Kryloff acceleration, you have really what is called the RAS algorithm. Okay, so now a very important concept in the domain decomposition on multigrid as well is to have more than one level. One level method are not scalable. So what I call one level method is a method where you have data exchange only between one subdomain and its direct neighbors. And you see that in this case, obviously the number of iterations to convergence will depend on the number of subdomains in one direction, just in order to move information from one side of the global domain to the other side, moving from one subdomain to the other. Okay, so the cure to this thing is to add a global correction, which is something which at each iteration will couple all subdomains. And from the linear algebra point of view, it is written in the following way. So let VH be a core space and Z be a matrix of VH. So you can imagine that Z is a tall and skinny rectangular matrix, where the number of lines corresponds to the size of the global problem. And the number of columns is the dimension of your core space. And okay, you define R naught is equal to Z transpose. And then what you can do is to modify the original reconditioner, the one level one, which is still written here. I deleted the partition of unity on purpose. I do not have time to explain why. And then you had what is called the coarse space correction. So here the matrix R0 transpose is a square matrix of small size. Its size is the dimension of the core space. Typically, it is something like the number of subdomains or some proportional to that. And when you invert it, you couple all subdomains. And so that now this new preconditioner couples all subdomains together. So the only thing left here now is to choose the core space VH. And I say domain decomposition method, the first good choice, let's say, was done by Nicolaides in 1987. And for the Poisson problem with the P1 discretization. So the idea was that it is important that you put in the core space at least what is in the kernel or the near kernel of the operator. So the Poisson operator, it is a constant function one. And you do it in a domain decomposition method fashion, which means that what you do is that you take your vector of ones, all ones, and since you have P1 function, it is the near kernel of the operator, and you restrict it to your subdomain, you multiply by the partition of unity, and you extend this by zero. And you do that for all subdomains. So now you have a core space of dimension, the number of subdomains, and it defines completely the method. Okay, so you have a lot of theoretical results on this method, just to mention one, for instance. You have this one, which tells you that the condition number of the precondition operator, with this two-level method, which is the key thing to have an estimate of the number of iterations you will need in the Kryloff method, is bounded by a constant times 1 plus h over delta, where h is the diameter of one subdomain and delta is the width of the overlap. And what is very important here is that the constant C here does not depend on the number of subdomains. You can double multiply by 4/8 the number of subdomains, the constant will not move, which means that you have what is called a scalable method. The number of iterations will not change, or very little, when you increase the number of subdomains. Okay, and in practice, it works very well as well. So here, just I give a table where you increase the number of subdomains from 8 to 64. And now the domains are stripwise, one after the other. And if you use the one-level method, you see that the iteration counts to convergence double each time you double the number of subdomains. Whereas if you use the two-level method with the Nicolaides core space, as iteration count is more or less stable, it is 27, 28. So this correction makes the method scalable. Okay, so this is very nice, but in fact, this constant will depend on the heterogeneities in the problem, and in a bad way. So that this thing is not enough when you have highly heterogeneous problems. And in this case, you need a larger and adaptive core space. In practice, you cannot design it by hand. You need some automatic way to do it. And we see what the Genio method is about. So, so we keep the same correction formula if you want, but now we build differently the core space. So skip that. Just to, okay. So how do we build it? So in each subdomain J, we solve a generalized eigenvalue problem, which is the following. So on the left, you have RGA, RG transpose, which is simply the restriction of your global matrix to your local subdomains to keep the rows and columns of your global matrix. DJ is the partition of unity, so you multiply it on the left and on the right. And what you have on the right, it is a Neumann matrix that Pierre mentioned in his talk, which corresponds to, let's say, the matrix that you get from your original formulation, variational formulation, but now in each subdomain without any boundary conditions. So it corresponds to Neumann gives you Neumann matrix for each subdomain. And the way to build the core space is written here. So what you do is that you fix some parameter tau, which is a user-chosen parameter. And in this generalized eigenvalue problem, you keep all the eigenvectors whose eigenvalues are larger than tau. And you put them in the core space a la Nicolaides. So you multiply by the partition of unity and you extend by zero. And okay, so what is important here is that these eigenvalue problems can be solved concurrently. They are really independent from each other. They do not involve any communication, so which is very good for parallelism. There is no data transfer. Okay. And one other good point is that it yes.
What does it mean lambda greater than tau?
No, no, okay, so you have an eigenvalue problem here. Yeah, so right. Lambda is the eigenvalue. Yes. So you have, well, let's say the first eigenvalue, let's say, would be like infinity because you have a kernel in the Neumann matrix. Okay, and then you have decreasing eigenvalue. And all the eigenvectors whose corresponding eigenvalues is larger than tau, you put them in the core space. Okay, as I've just said, answering Olivier's question, is that what is good is that if you have what is called a floating subdomain, a subdomain which does not touch the exterior boundary, then the function one for a Poisson problem will be in the kernel, which means that here it will correspond to an infinite eigenvalue, and automatically it will be placed in the core space. Okay, and it works. Well, first, there is a theory for it. So, this was the PhD work of Nicole Spillane, and there were several other people involved in it. And the good thing is that you have a condition number estimate of the global thing, which depends only on the parameter tau, which is chosen by the user, and K0, which is basically the number of neighbors of one subdomain. And everything is explicit. So there is no hidden constant here, as before. And also, it does not depend on the number of subdomains. Okay, so you really have a scalable method. The only thing which is maybe not scalable is the size of the core space, which could be large or small, depending on the difficulty of your problem. Okay, and so we made some tests. And here, we have convergence curves for highly heterogeneous diffusion problem. So in blue, okay, so what do you have? You have the iteration count here. Here you have the log of the error. And in blue, you have the convergence of the one level method. So it's pretty slow. In red, you have the convergence of the two-level method with the Nicolaides core space, which was efficient for a constant coefficient problem, but which is not enough for a highly heterogeneous diffusion problem. And then in green, you have some variance of our Gineo core space. And you see that convergence is very nice. Okay, so this is fast recall on the Gineo method. So now I will speak about its extension to saddle point problem, which is a new stuff here. Okay, so I just give very quickly the way it works. Okay, so what is known when you have a saddle point problem is that if you want to have a spectrally equivalent preconditioner to your global matrix, let's say, it is enough to be able to precondition the first block A and the sure complement of this matrix. And the only good thing in saddle point problem formulation is that the saddle point is a symmetric positive definite matrix, and it is the sum of two positive matrices, which is very helpful. So the first thing we do is that you must imagine that here you have, for instance, a velocity pressure formulation. So A is a velocity block, and the last line corresponds to the pressure equation. Okay, so the first thing you do is that you use what I've shown before, so the GNU core space to precondition the matrix A, and you plug this approximation in here so that you have a spectrally equivalent matrix to the sure complement. The sure complement applies to the pressure amount. Okay, now if I develop, I use the formula, let's say, that defines the two-level Genéo method, and I regroup terms in some way, what I get is that, in fact, the sure complement is equivalent to a sure complement which corresponds to the core space on the velocity, so S0, plus the sum over the subdomains of what comes from the original one-level method. Okay, and now I say that in order to precondition S, I will precondition MS1. So MS1 is a full matrix because here you have the inverse of your sure complement, in fact, and you have a sum of them. But what is very helpful is that it is a sum of local sure complements, so that it can be preconditioned by a specialist or a Genéo-Neumann-Neumann type method, where basically you take the pseudo-inverse of these local matrices, which is written here. You use the partition of UDT on the pressure block, so it is a D tilde I, and in order to have a spectrally equivalent thing, you have to build a core space for this thing. So this is an extra work to do. And you have to add some extra projection on something. You have some work to get it. Okay, and now the last thing is that we define a spectrally equivalent preconditioner to S, which is called NS, which is simply the sum of S0 and MS1. And when we have to apply it, we have to solve, in fact, a linear system in P, with a matrix, let's say, NS. And for this, we solve it by using a Krylov solver with the preconditioner of S1 as a preconditioner. So in fact, you have nested loops in the preconditioner. Okay, and to sum the algorithm, it's written here. So let's say you have the right-hand side, and the output would be the solution, velocity and pressure. So the first thing to do is to eliminate the velocity if you want. So to solve a linear system with A using the Genéo classical method, I would say. Then to update the right-hand side for the pressure. Then to solve a system with a sure complement on the pressure, preconditioned by this matrix that I've just defined. And once it's at convergence, then you can recover the good velocity. And you are you have to update the right-hand side for the velocity, and then solve again one problem for the velocity and you are done. Okay, so I will show some numerical results, and Pierre-Henri will show some FFDDM script. Okay, so we decided to apply this to the nearly incompressible elasticity system because it is a difficult one. So here I've written the energy, mechanical energy, which depends on two parameters, mu and lambda, which are the Lamé coefficients, and which are defined as a function of the Young modulus and the Poisson ratio nu. Okay, and what is important is that when you have a nearly incompressible material, it corresponds to, the other way. As nu is getting close to 1/2, because of this term here, the parameter lambda goes to infinity. And so it means that in the energy, you have a very strong penalization, but it's not a penalization, it's the energy that like this, of the divergence, which means that the divergence should be small in order to have low energy. So you are in a situation where the vernier link compressible. And for instance, for rubber, the exact coefficient for nu, let's say, is 0.4999, so we have 3 9. Okay, and now, even though the energy can be written only in terms of the velocity, when you discretize it, you have to introduce the pressure. Why is that? Because, in fact, you have two competing parameters. You have lambda, which is very, very large, and you have the divergence, which is very, very small. And if you keep them together, doesn't work, so you have to draw the pressure, which is the product of these two things. And the good thing is that as nu tends to 1/2, so as you approach incompressibility, this pressure has a continuous limit. And so in discretization, you have to introduce the pressure. And once you do that, you have this variational formulation. Okay, and so that when you go to the matrices, you have a saddle point formulation. And now what is important in our work is that we are able to consider a classical lowest order Taylor Hood finite element discretization, where you have a continuous P2 velocity and a continuous P1 pressure. And in fact, the fact that the pressure is continuous makes the problem more difficult, much more difficult than when you have a discontinuous pressure from an algebraic point of view, solver point of view. Okay, so we applied it to a classical test case, let's say, which is a kind of sandwich of rubber and steel. The coefficients are given here, where you have a typical domain decomposition into 16 subdomains that we get per matrix. So what is important here is that you have high heterogeneities because the rubber is nearly incompressible, whereas the steel is compressible, if you are strong enough. And the rubber is very soft, but steel is very hard. Okay, so they don't react in the same way. And you see that the domain decomposition does not fit with the coefficient of the problem. So it makes things harder, but more general. Okay, so so I will show some numerical results. Our first weak scalability test. So there are many columns. I have no time to explain all of them. So the thing is that the number of unknowns is given here. So we start from 15 million degrees of freedom on the 262 cores, and we end up with 1 billion degrees of freedom on the 16,000 cores. And here you have the iteration counts for the global solver, which are very stable, let's say, it's about 30 iterations. And here you have the time. So a perfect weak scaling, as Pierre explained, should be a flat time to solution. We're more or less at it until 4,000 cores. And then, because of the size of the core space, things degrade, but not too badly, and the time increases. So all these numerical results can be reproduced using the script that is pointed here and that Pierre-Henri will explain soon. Okay, so we made comparisons with direct solvers. So as I said, when your problem is small, for instance, 100,000 cores, so, direct solvers work very well and they are fast. You get solution in 7 seconds. You don't have to bother about anything difficult. And here it is our solver. But as you increase the size of the problem, for instance, if you go to 3 million degrees of freedom, you already see that things are not so are still better for MEMS, but it depends on the number of cores you use, for instance. If you use many cores, then we are faster. And when you go to 8 million degrees of freedom, then obviously the direct solver suffers. And it is only, I would say, 8 million degrees of freedom. So if you go to higher, the direct solver is lost. And OOM means out of memory, because the problem with the direct solver is memory. Okay, so we try to do comparison with the algebraic multigrid method, but for the problem we consider, which is very difficult, we were not able to have it work on the velocity pressure formulation. So what we did is a comparison only on the velocity formulation. And so for nu, we start at 0.48, little bit compressible, and then to nearly incompressible thing. And you see that as you increase, as you go to incompressibility, the iteration count increases with algebraic multigrid and then it doesn't converge. Whereas in our case, please note, there is an increase, but once again, this is only the velocity formulation and not the velocity pressure, because for the velocity pressure, we have very stable iteration times. Okay, so Pierre-Henri, how do you tu parles après, c'est ça?
Yeah, maybe this is our question, or not.
Okay. Don't know if there are questions or comments. No sound. Oh, oui, c'est quand j'ai démarré. Okay. Okay. Il y a des points de question, yes?
I have a question.
Yeah, yes. Yes,
on, yes. On the explanation of the preconditioner, you said the Neumann-Neumann type method. There is a pseudo inverse there. Mm-hmm. But this pseudo inverse only concerning about the kind of the constant kernel space for the pressure or six rigid mode for the elasticity.
Okay, so the idea here is once again to do some Gino stuff. What I mean is that we do not prescribe in advance what we put in the core space. So the core space is obtained by solving another generalized eigenvalue problem in each subdomain, but now corresponding to the pressure block.
On the only pressure block, yes.
And this way, we adapt automatically to the difficulty of the problem. So for easy problems, I would say continuous coefficient problems, basically, you have nothing to do. And when you have a lot of heterogeneities, then you populate this new core space ZS.
Thank you. So
yes?
Effect of the heterogeneity is already solved inside of the RA transpose one. So local problem can solve the heterogeneity.
Yes, if they are inside, yes. But if the heterogeneities cross the boundaries, the interfaces, then yes. You have to do something in the core space.
Uh-huh.
And in many other domain decomposition method solvers, they have to ensure that the subdomains resolve the discontinuities in order to converge. And in our case, we can have arbitrary things.
Yes, I understand. Yes, but yeah, thank you. So but this preconditioner seems to be based on kind of the user method.
So we are very late. So okay. If you want to start the tutorial, I think you
okay.
Must stop here.
Okay, Pierre-Henri, yes. Pierre-Henri, oui, il doit montrer les scripts. Voilà.